Dear students, I welcome you all for the second lecture of Unit 5 of Engineering Mechanics. So, Unit 5, we have dynamics of particles. So, in the first lecture, we have seen kinematics of particles, and in that, we have discussed about rectilinear motion of particles. Now, in this particular lecture, we are going to see about curvilinear motion, and we are going to see about the projectile motion of particles. So the contents what we are going to cover in this particular lecture are, so definition of projectile motion, and then we are going to see about the motion of a projectile on a horizontal plane. So we are going to see the concepts involved on the motion of a projectile on a horizontal plane. Then we are going to see some of the solved problems on the projectile on a horizontal plane. Then we are going to move to the motion of a projectile on an inclined plane. So we are going to discuss the concepts of projectile on an inclined plane, and after that we are going to see some of the problems on projectile which is moving on an inclined plane. Now first of all, let us see what is meant by a projectile. So now you can see this figure. So you have a particle which is projected from the point O. So the particle is projected from the point O at a velocity of u. So in the previous lectures in the rectilinear motion of particles, so we have discussed about the motion of the particles along a straight line, and there we have discussed three cases where the particle moves horizontally in a straight line, or when a particle is moving along a straight line vertically upwards, or when a particle is moving down in a straight line from a particular height. But here, if you see this particular figure, here the particle is projected upwards with a certain velocity and with some angle of projection. Now, if you see in this figure, so the particle is projected with a velocity of u and the angle of the projection is alpha. So that is, the particle is projected at a certain velocity at an angle alpha with the horizontal. And since the particle is projected with a certain velocity at an angle alpha, so this velocity will have two components. So one horizontal component and another one a vertical component. So the horizontal component of this velocity u will become u cos alpha, and the vertical component of the velocity u will become u sin alpha. So you have the two components of the velocity. So the horizontal component of the velocity u cos alpha will make the particle to move in the horizontal direction, whereas the vertical component of the velocity u, that is u sin alpha, will make the particle to move upwards. Now this particle, so when it is projected with a velocity u, so it will move to a certain height, and again it will come down and it will fall at a certain point. So this point O is the starting point, and this is the point, this point A is the point at which the projectile or the particle reaches the ground. So this is the, if you can see this figure, so this curve, it shows the motion of the particle or the path of the particle. So this path or this motion, we call it as projectile motion. So we can call a projectile as a particle which is moving under the action of both horizontal force as well as vertical force. So here the horizontal force is u cos alpha and the vertical force is u sin alpha. So the particle is going to move under the influence of both the horizontal component of the velocity and the vertical component of the velocity. So if it is subjected to both horizontal force and the vertical force, so the particle, when it is projected at an angle alpha, it will move along this path. So this is the path of the particle. So a projectile, we can define this as a particle which is moving under the combined effect of vertical and horizontal forces. We call it as a projectile. So again, this horizontal component of the velocity will make the particle to move horizontally, and the vertical component of the velocity will make the particle to move vertically. So this is the starting point of the particle, and after reaching a certain height, again it will come down and it will fall on the ground at a point A. So this point O is called as point of projection, and this point A is nothing but the point at which the particle reaches the ground. Now if you note that the horizontal component of the velocity will remain constant, So it doesn't have any external influences. Therefore, this u cos alpha will be constant at every point of the motion of the particle. But if you take the vertical component of the velocity, u sin alpha, it will not be constant throughout its entire path, because if a particle is moving upward, so it will be under the influence of gravitational acceleration. Therefore, this particular component u sin alpha will not be constant at each and every point of the path of the particle. Now here, let us see some of the basic definitions in the projectile motion. So the first definition is trajectory. So trajectory is nothing but the path traced by a projectile in the space is known as trajectory. So if you look at this diagram here, the particle is projected from this point, it is moving like this, it is moving and it is coming down at the point A. So this line, it indicates the path of the, or the path which is traveled by the particle. So this path we call it as a trajectory. And the next definition is velocity of projection. So this u is called as velocity of the projection. It is nothing but the velocity at which the projectile is projected. And the next thing is angle of projection. So this alpha is called as angle of projection. So this angle is with respect to horizontal. So this is nothing but the angle at which the particle is projected with certain velocity. So this alpha is called as angle of projection. Next you have an important definition which is called as time of flight. So time of flight is nothing but the time, the total time which is taken by the particle to reach maximum height and then to return back to the ground. So it is the particle is starting from this point. So at certain time it will reach the maximum height. Then after that it will again return back to the ground. So this time of flight is nothing but the total time taken by the particle to start from O and again to come back to the point A. So that is called as time of flight. And you have range. So range is nothing but the distance covered by the particle, that is the horizontal distance. So this range is nothing but the distance between the point O and the point A. So that is called as range. So point O is nothing but the point of projection and A is nothing but the point at which the particle or projectile reaches the ground. So this distance OA is called as the range of the projectile. And this range, it may be sometimes horizontal or it may be sometimes inclined also. Now if you take this particular particle, the particle is projected at certain velocity on a horizontal plane. Suppose in some cases the particle may be projected so at a certain velocity in an inclined plane also. So if a particle is projected on an inclined plane, then the range also may be inclined. Now in this case the range is horizontal. So the range is nothing but the distance between O and A, which is nothing but the distance between the point of projection of the projectile and the point at which the projectile reaches the ground. Now let us see how to derive the equation of the path of a particle. So as you know, when a particle is projected upwards, it follows certain path before reaching the ground. So we can derive the equation of the path of a projectile. So it's a very simple derivation. So you can see here, use the velocity of projection and alpha is the angle of projection and u cos alpha is the horizontal component of the velocity of projection and u sin alpha is nothing but the vertical component of velocity of the projection. Now you can see this p is nothing but the position of the particle after a certain time. So let that time be t seconds. So after time t seconds, the particle, it reaches the position p. So now this is x and this is y. Now we know that the horizontal component of the velocity is u cos alpha. So u cos alpha. Similarly, the vertical component of the velocity is u sin alpha. Now in order to get this vertical height or vertical distance, so we make use of the equation, that is s is equal to ut plus half gt square. But here s is nothing but y. So y is equal to ut, so minus half gt square, because so here we have put minus because the particle is moving upwards, so which is against the direction of acceleration due to gravity. So the gravity will be acting downwards, gravitational acceleration will be acting downwards. whereas the particle is moving upwards. Therefore, here we have included minus sign, that is minus half gt square. Therefore, now we are getting this vertical distance y from this basic equation, that is s is equal to ut minus half gt square. So instead of s, we are putting y here. And here the velocity, since it is a vertical distance, we are using the vertical component of the velocity. So now u becomes u sine alpha. So u sine alpha t minus, so this minus sign is because the particle is moving upwards, which is against the direction of acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, we are putting minus sign. So we are getting y is equal to u sine alpha t minus half gt square. And similarly, you can calculate this horizontal distance. So this horizontal distance is nothing but the velocity into time. So velocity here, the horizontal velocity. So the horizontal velocity is, since x is the horizontal distance, here we make use of the horizontal velocity, that is u cos alpha into t. So from this equation, we are getting time. So t is equal to, we have x by u cos alpha. Now we are substituting this value of t back in the y equation. So after substituting this value of t in the y equation, we get y is equal to x tan alpha minus gx square by 2u square cos square alpha. Now if you look at this particular equation, now we have established a relationship between y and x. So if you look at this equation, so this involves x square. So that means that it's a parabolic equation. Therefore, this equation, it represents the equation of a parabola. That means that the path of the projectile, or the particle, that is the particle, it moves from here to here. So it follows a certain path. So the path which is followed by the particle is nothing but, or the trajectory is nothing but a parabola. So from this equation, it's very clear that it is a parabolic equation. Therefore, the path of a projectile is also a parabola. So this is a very simple derivation. So this p is nothing but the position of the particle after time t seconds. So x is the horizontal distance and y is the vertical distance at the point p. So we are estimating the horizontal distances and the vertical distance. So horizontal distances, horizontal component of the velocity into time. Therefore, x is equal to u cos alpha into t. Similarly, vertical distances, we can find s is equal to ut minus half gt square. So here the vertical component is u sine alpha, therefore u sine alpha t minus half gt square. So then since this the motion of a particle is upwards, the acceleration due to gravity is downwards. Therefore here you have a negative sign. Therefore you get a y equation like this. And from this equation we get t as this. After substituting this t here, we get an equation for y. So this equation is a parabolic equation. So which implies that the path of a projectile is a parabola. Now we can find out the time of flight also. So we know that time of flight is nothing but the time taken by the particle to travel from O to A. That is, the total time of flight is nothing but the time taken by the particle to travel from O to A. So now we are going to find out that particular time of flight. Again, we make use of the distance equation, that is S is equal to ut plus half at square. So here, if you note the point A, if you take this particular point, the y will be equal to 0. So at this point A, y will be equal to 0. So if you have this equation, y is equal to u sine alpha t minus half gt square. So at the point A, that is y will be equal to 0. So we are substituting y is equal to 0 here. So from this, you get u sine alpha t minus half gt square is equal to 0. From this, u sine alpha t is equal to half gt square. From this, we get time is equal to 2u sine alpha divided by g. So this is the time of flight. So simply, we are making use of the condition at point A, y will be equal to 0. Now, in order to find the horizontal range, so range is nothing but the distance between the point O and A. That is, you have to find out this horizontal distance. So distance can be calculated simply by multiplying the velocity and the time. So we know the time of flight already, which is already estimated as 2u sine alpha by g. So distance or the range is equal to velocity into time. So here means horizontal velocity. So horizontal velocity into time of flight. So time of flight, you can simply substitute this value, that is 2u sine alpha by g, and horizontal velocity is nothing but u cos alpha. So when you substitute both the values of velocity and time, so you get the range value as u square sine 2 alpha by g. Now we can see here, for the range to be maximum, suppose if you want to find out the condition at which the range is going to be maximum. Now if you look at this particular equation, you have r is equal to u square sine 2 alpha by g. Now if you look at this equation, this r will become maximum when sine 2 alpha here will become 1. That is if sine 2 alpha is equal to 1, then the range will be maximum. That means that when sine 2 alpha is equal to 1, your 2 alpha will be 90 degree. So sine 2 alpha will be 90 degree, or sine 90 will be equal to 1. We know that sine 90 equal to 1. Therefore 2 alpha will be equal to 90 degree. From this alpha is equal to 45 degree. So when alpha is equal to 45 degree, the range will be maximum. So if you substitute alpha here, sine 90, so it will become 1. Therefore r maximum will become u square sine 90 by g, which is equal to u square by g. Since sine 90 is equal to 1, we get the maximum range as u square by g. Therefore, for the range value to be maximum in this equation, sine 2 alpha should be equal to 1, or alpha should be 45 degree. Therefore, if a particle is projected at an angle alpha which is equal to 45 degree with respect to horizontal, then the particle will have a maximum range. So that is the understanding. Now, let us find out the maximum height of a projectile on a horizontal plane. So you have to find out the maximum height of the maximum height which is traveled by a particle on a horizontal plane. And now we know that the vertical component of the velocity is u sin alpha, because we are going to here find out the maximum height. Therefore, we need the vertical component of the velocity, and we know very well that the vertical component of the velocity is u sin alpha. And if you take at the maximum height, the velocity will be equal to 0. The final velocity will be equal to 0. That is, the vertical component of the velocity will be equal to 0. Therefore, at point O, the velocity is going to be u sin alpha. And similarly, at the point of maximum height, the velocity will be equal to 0. Now, when we need to find the maximum height of the projectile, we need to find the maximum height of the projectile. So for that, we need two velocities. One is the initial velocity at the point O. Another one is the velocity at the maximum height. So what velocity at the maximum height is equal to 0. Now the average velocity between these two points is nothing but u sin alpha plus 0 divided by 2. So we get u sin alpha by 2. And we know that the total time of flight is, so which we have derived already, the total time of flight is nothing but the time required by the particle to travel from O to A. So that is 2u sin alpha by g. But now we are focusing only the maximum height. Therefore, the time taken by the particle to travel from O to the maximum height will be half of the total time of flight. Therefore, the time taken by the projectile to reach the maximum height will be u sin alpha by g. Now, in order to get the maximum height, so we know the equation that height is equal to velocity into time. So here we are making use of the average vertical velocity, which is nothing but the average of velocity at this point and velocity at the maximum height. So we get u sin alpha by 2. So the distance or the maximum height of the projectile is equal to the average vertical velocity into time. So which means u sin alpha by 2 into the time taken by the projectile to reach the maximum height. So u sin alpha by g. So when you multiply this and this, we get the maximum height of the projectile is equal to u square sin square alpha by 2g. So these equations will be helpful for solving the problems in order to get the maximum height of the projectile when a particle is projected on a horizontal plane. Now with this background, let us see some of the problems on the motion of a projectile which is moving on a horizontal plane. Now the first problem is, a projectile is fired upwards at an angle of 30 degree with a velocity of 40 meter per second. Calculate the time taken by the projectile to reach the ground after the instant of firing. So now here the angle of the projection is given, which is 30 degree. Velocity is given as 40 meter per second. So this is nothing but the velocity of projection, and you have to take estimate the total time of flight, that is time taken by the projectile reach the ground after the instant of firing. So we know the equation for total time of flight, which is equal to 2u sine alpha by g. So here now 2 into u is the velocity is 40 meter per second, and the alpha is 30 degree, which is given. So g 9.8. So after substituting all the values, you can get the total time of flight as 4.08 seconds. It's a very simple problem to find out the total time of flight. So given the angle of projection and the velocity of projection. Now moving to the second problem. So here a ball is projected upwards with a velocity of 15 meter per second at an angle of 25 degree with the horizontal. What is the horizontal range of the ball? So here you have to get the horizontal range. So for range also we know the equation. So r is equal to u square sine 2 alpha by g. So here u is nothing but the velocity of projection, and alpha is the angle of projection. G is the acceleration due to gravity. So here the value of u is given as 15 meter per second, and angle of projection is given as 25 degree. So after substituting all the values, we get the horizontal range of the ball as 17.6 meters. So this is also a simple problem which makes use of the equation of the range. And the third problem is a bullet is fired with a velocity of 100 meter per second at an angle of 45 degree with the horizontal. How high the bullet will rise? That means that you have to find the maximum height which is reached by the bullet. So we have discussed about this in the previous slide. So the maximum height is given by this equation, that is u square sine square alpha by 2g. So here u is given, that is 100 meter per second, alpha is also given. So after substituting all the values, we can get the maximum height reached by the bullet. So the answer is 255.1 meters. Now the fourth problem, a body is projected at such an angle that the horizontal range is 3 times the greatest height. So find the angle of projection. So here a condition is given, that is the question is you have to find the angle of projection, that is you have to find alpha, and the condition given here is the horizontal range is 3 times the greatest height, that is you know the equation for range. So we know that the range is u square sine 2 alpha by g, and also you know the equation for the maximum height reached by the body. So the maximum height reached by the body is u square sine square alpha by 2g. So now the condition is the range is 3 times the maximum height. So now the range is equal to 3 times the maximum height. So just we are applying this condition. So after applying this condition, we are simplifying for alpha. So after simplification, we get tan alpha is equal to 1.333. From this, alpha is equal to 53.1 degree. Therefore, the angle of projection here is 53.1 degree. So now here, we are evaluating this angle of projection based on the given condition. So the given condition here is the range is 3 times the maximum height reached by the body. So from the equation of range and similarly from the equation of maximum height, so we are applying the given condition, and from that condition, we are estimating the value of angle of projection. Now the problem number 5 is you have a particle which is thrown with a velocity of 5 meter per second at an elevation of 60 degrees to the horizontal. Find the velocity of another particle thrown at an elevation of 45 degree which will have equal horizontal range, B equal maximum height, and C equal time of flight. So here here we have a case where you have two particles. So the first particle is thrown with a velocity of 5 meter per second and the angle of projection of particle 1 is 60 degrees. Whereas for the second particle, the angle of projection is 45 degree. But you have to find out the velocity of the second particle. So for the condition given, the condition given here is, so it should have a equal horizontal range as that of particle 1. Similarly, the second condition is, it should have equal maximum height reached by particle 1 and particle 2 should be same. So for this condition, you have to find the velocity of the second particle. And similarly, the third condition is particle 1 and particle 2 should have the equal time of flight. So for these three conditions, you have to find out the velocity of the second particle. Now let the velocity of the first particle is indicated as u1, which is given as 5 meter per second. Similarly, the angle of projection of the first particle can be denoted as alpha 1. So alpha 1 is equal to 60 degrees here. And alpha 2 is given, which is nothing but the angle of projection of the second particle, which is 45 degree. So alpha 2 is 45 degree. And we have to get the velocity of the second particle, so which can be denoted as u2. So u2 is nothing but the velocity of the projection of the second particle. So you have to find out u2 for three different conditions. So the first condition is both the particles should have equal horizontal range. Second condition is both the particles should have equal maximum height. And the third condition is both the particles should have the equal time of flight. So you know the equations for each parameter. So for example, for the horizontal range, the equation is this. R is equal to u square sine 2 alpha by g. Similarly, for maximum height, so this is the equation. So h is equal to u square sine square alpha by g. So you have to equate the range of particle 1 and range of particle 2. So this is the range of particle 1. So here u becomes u1 and alpha becomes alpha 1. Similarly here, this is the range of the particle 2. U becomes u2 and alpha becomes alpha 2. So after substituting the known values, so you get the unknown value, that is the velocity of the second particle as 4.65 meter per second. So this is the first problem. And the second problem is you have to find out the velocity u2 for the condition that both the particles will have the same maximum height. So you know the equation for the maximum height. So h is equal to u square sine square alpha by 2g. Now for the first particle, this is the equation for the maximum height, u1 alpha 1. And similarly, this is the maximum height equation for the second particle. So u becomes u2 here and alpha becomes alpha 2 here. So after substituting all the values given, so we get the velocity of the second particle as 6.12 meter per second. And coming to the third problem here, so here the condition is both the particles should have the equal time of flight. So this is the equation for time of flight. So we know t is equal to 2u sine alpha by g. So when the two particles should have the equal time of flight, so this should be the condition which has to be applied. So this is the time of flight for particle 1 and this is the time of flight for particle 2. So here u1 and alpha 1. Similarly for particle 2, you have u2 and alpha 2. So after substituting all the known values, we get the velocity of the second particle as 6.12 meter per second. Now the next interesting problem is, so you have a projectile which is aimed at a mark on a horizontal plane through the point of projection. It falls 12 meters short when the angle of projection is 15 degrees. While it overshoots the mark by 24 meters when the same angle is 45 degree. Find the angle of projection to hit the mark. Assume no air resistance. So this is the problem. This problem is a very interesting problem. So here, the given condition is you have to hit this mark, that is R. So your particle or your projectile should hit this mark. So for this condition, so you have to find out the angle of the projection. So at which angle or what angle your particle should be projected in order to reach this particular mark or in order to have a range of R. So that is the question. So for that you have again two conditions given. So suppose if the same particle is projected at an angle of 15 degree, if the angle of projection is 15 degree, so it falls 12 meters short. So it falls here. Your actual mark is here. So R1 is nothing but, so if the particle is projected at 15 degrees, the range is R1. So which is 12 meters short of R. Similarly, the second condition is if the particle is projected at 45 degree, the range is 24 meters excess. So when compared to R, it is 24 meters it overshoots. So for this condition, you have to find out the angle of projection in order to hit this particular mark R. So the condition is, for an angle of projection of 15 degree, the range is R1. Similarly, when the angle of projection is 45 degree, the range is R2. So you have to find at which angle of projection the range is equal to R. So the question is very simple. Now, so everything is based on your range. So this problem is completely based on the range. So now you take the range equation. So the horizontal range equation. So we know the equation of range, which is u square sine 2 alpha by g. Now you take the first case, that is R1. So R1 is equal to u square sine 2 alpha 1 by g. So alpha 1, you substitute the value as 15 degree. Now this R1 is nothing but R minus 12. Because if the angle is projected, or if the angle of projection is 15 degree, it falls 12 meters short of the mark. Therefore, your R1 is nothing but R minus 12. So here, instead of R1, I am going to substitute R minus 12. So you get a first equation. Similarly, if you take the second case, when the angle of projection is 45 degree, the range is R2. Now you are writing an equation for R2. So R2 is nothing but u square sine 2 alpha 2 divided by g. Here alpha 2 is 45 degree. And here R2 is nothing but R plus 24. From this diagram, you can see this R2 is nothing but R plus 24. So instead of R2, I am substituting R plus 24. So the first equation, I am getting R minus 12. And the second equation, I am getting R plus 24. So now I am dividing equation 1 by 2. I am doing some simplifications, because both equations contains R. Therefore, I am simplifying equation 1 and equation 2. So when you simplify equation 1 and 2, so we get the range R as 48 meters. Now we got the range. Now the question is, you have to find the angle of the projection to hit the mark. So now the range is known, that is 48 meter. So you have to find the angle of projection, that is alpha. So at which angle the particle should be projected in order to obtain a range of 48 meters. So for that, again, after knowing the value of R, we get the velocity equation. By substituting the value of R in any one equation, we get u square is equal to 72 into g. Now you have to find the angle of projection. So for that, we know the range equation, because now the range is 48 meters. So now we know the equation of range is u square sine 2 alpha by g. So instead of u square, now you substitute 72g. So after substituting u square value here, so we get the value of alpha as 20.9 degrees. Therefore, when the given particle is projected at an angle of 20.9 degrees, then the value of range will be equal to 48 meters. Now we'll see the next problem. So the next problem is, you have a projectile fired from the edge of a 150 meter high cliff with an initial velocity of 180 meter per second at an angle of elevation of 30 degrees with the horizontal. Neglecting air resistance, find number 1, the greatest elevation above the ground reached by the projectile, and number 2, the horizontal distance from the gun to the point where the projectile strikes the ground. So now when you compare this problem with the previous problem, so in previous problems, actually the projectile is fired from the ground. Whereas in this particular case, here you have a projectile which is projected at an angle of 30 degrees with a velocity of 180 meter per second. So it is projected from a 150 meter high cliff or a small hill. So instead of projecting from the ground, here in this case, the particle is projected from a certain height, that is 150 meter from the ground. So now the question is, you have to find the greatest elevation above the ground reached by the projectile. That means that you have to find out the maximum height from the ground, the maximum height reached by the projectile. So that has to be measured from the ground. So that is the first question. So you have to find the greatest elevation above the ground reached by the projectile. And the second question is, you have to find the horizontal distance, that is marked here, that is R. So R, so that is nothing but the distance from the gun to the point at which the projectile strikes the ground. So you have two questions here. So the first question is, you have to find the greatest elevation above the ground, that is you have to find this particular height, and the second question is you have to find out this particular distance r. So the condition here is the particle is projected from a certain height, that is 150 meter from the ground level, at a velocity of 180 meter per second and at an angle of projection of 30 degrees. Now we know the equation for the maximum height reached by the projectile, that is from this level. Now you draw a horizontal line here. So you can see here, this is the horizontal line which is drawn through the point O. Now for this we know the equation. So this h is nothing but the maximum height reached by the projectile when it is projected from the horizontal plane. Now you draw a, so you can see here a dotted line. Now from this reference line you can find out this h. So if now you know the basic equation for the maximum height reached by the projectile, which is nothing but u square sin square alpha by 2g. Now the u, the initial velocity is given 180 meter per second. The angle of projection is 30 degrees. And after substituting the values, you can find this h. Now we need to find out the greatest elevation above the ground. So that is nothing but this h plus 150. Therefore, the greatest elevation above the ground, which is reached by the projectile, is equal to this height h plus 150, which is equal to 563.3 meters. So the first question we have solved. And moving to the second question, the second question is, you have to find the horizontal distance from the gun to the point where the projectile reaches the ground. So you have to find out this horizontal distance r. So for this, now let us consider first the motion of the projectile from this point to the maximum height. So first, in order to find out this horizontal distance r, now let us first consider the motion of the projectile from the point O to the maximum point of maximum height. So now we know the equation of the maximum, the time taken for the projectile to reach the maximum height. So we know that the total time of flight is 2u sin alpha by g. Therefore, the time taken by the projectile to reach from the starting point to the maximum height will be half of that. Therefore, u sin alpha by g. So this is the time taken by the particle to reach the maximum height. So that is taken as t1. So this t1 is nothing but the time taken by the projectile to travel from O to the point of maximum height. So that is t1, which is u sin alpha by g. Now u is 180, alpha is 30 degree. Therefore, we get t1 is equal to 9.2 seconds. Now you have to find out t2. So this t2 is nothing but again the time taken by the particle to travel from this maximum height to the point A. So that can be taken as t2. So when you add t1 plus t2, it is nothing but the total time taken by the particle to travel from the point O to the point A. So after finding out the time t, so we can find out the distance r by simply multiplying the velocity into time. So now the next job is to find the t2. So t2 is nothing but the time taken by the projectile to reach the ground from the maximum height. So t1 is nothing but the time taken by the projectile to travel from O to the point of maximum height, whereas t2 is nothing but the time taken by the projectile to travel from the maximum height to the point on the ground. So that is nothing but t2. So in order to find out this t2, so you know the condition at the point of maximum height, the velocity will become zero. So at the point of maximum height, we know the distance also, the vertical distance also. Vertical distance, that is from the ground we know, that is which is estimated already. So that is 563.3 meters. So at the point of maximum height, your particle is at a distance of 563.3 meters from the ground level. So at the point of maximum height, your velocity is zero. Now the distance is 563.3 meters. Now you know the equation of motion, that is s is equal to ut plus half gt square. So now here we are using plus here because the particle is going to travel from the point of maximum height to the ground. Therefore, it is moving downwards. So when it is moving downwards, the particle, it is going to move in a direction which is similar to the direction of acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, here it will be plus. Therefore, s is equal to ut plus half gt square. So the initial velocity is 0 since it is traveling from the maximum height. So initial velocity will be equal to 0. And the maximum height is 563.3. So from this equation, you are getting t2 as 10.7 seconds. So already in the previous slide, we have estimated t1. So which is nothing but the time taken by the particle to travel from O to the point of maximum height. So this t2 is nothing but the time taken by the particle to travel from maximum height to the ground. Therefore, the total time taken by the projectile to reach the ground from the edge of the cliff is equal to t1 plus t2. So we are adding those two values of times. So we get t1 plus t2 is equal to 19.9 seconds. Now we need to get the horizontal distance, that is r. So r is nothing but the horizontal distance from the point of firing to the point at which the projectile reaches the ground. So we need to get the horizontal distance r. So this distance can be calculated simply by multiplying the time and the velocity. So now, since it is a horizontal distance, we have to take the horizontal component of velocity, which is nothing but u cos alpha. So here u is 180, alpha is 30, therefore 180 cos 30 into the total time is 19.9 seconds. Therefore, if you multiply the horizontal component of velocity and the time, you can get the horizontal distance. So after some simplification or after substitution, we get the value of horizontal distance as 3102 meters, which is nothing but 3.102 kilometers. So far we have discussed about the motion of a particle, so which was projected with some initial velocity u and which was projected at certain angle of inclination, that is alpha, with respect to horizontal. And we have seen some of these solved problems also in order to find out the total time of flight and also to find out the maximum height reached by the projectile. And also we have seen some problems to find out the horizontal range of the projectile. Now, here, so we are going to derive some equations in order to find out the velocity and direction of motion of a projectile after a given interval of time from the instant of projection. So now, if you look at this diagram, so this is the point O from which the particle is projected. So it is projected at an initial velocity of u and the angle of projection is alpha. Now, after a certain interval of time, so the particle is going to reach a position, or it is going to reach the point P. So at the point P, so the velocity of the particle will now be v. Now, this theta is nothing but the angle which the particle makes with the horizontal. So now let us understand it clearly. So this is the starting point from which the particle is projected. So it is projected at an initial velocity of u and the angle of projection is alpha. So after a certain interval of time, the particle reaches the point P or the position P. So at the point P, now the velocity of the projectile at the point P is indicated as small v, and this angle theta is nothing but the angle which the projectile at P makes with the horizontal. Now we are going to find out the velocity and also the direction of the motion of a projectile after a given interval of time. So now here, use the initial velocity of the projection, as I said earlier, and alpha is the angle of the projection, so which is known to us already. And this v is the velocity of the projectile at the point P. Similarly, this theta is nothing but angle which the projectile at the point P makes with the horizontal. Now, we know that the initial velocity has two components, u cos alpha and u sin alpha. So the vertical component of the initial velocity is u sin alpha. Now the vertical component of the final velocity, that is after t seconds, the velocity is v. So the vertical component of the final velocity is v sin theta. So now there is a change in velocity. So u sin alpha, the initial velocity is u sin alpha. Now it is changed to v sin theta. So whereas if you take the horizontal component of the velocity, u cos alpha, so here the horizontal component of the velocity is v cos theta. So there will not be any change in the horizontal component of the velocity. Therefore, u cos alpha will be equal to v cos theta. Whereas if you take the vertical component of the velocity, here it is u sin alpha, whereas at the position P, the vertical component is v sin theta. Both will not be equal because since the particle is moving upwards, the direction of the motion of the particle is against the acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, we have the retardation. So, g due to gravity. Therefore, the velocity at this particular position at point P will now be equal to v sin theta, so which is nothing but equal to the initial velocity, that is u sin alpha minus g into t. So, this minus sign indicates that due to the upward motion of the motion, so here we have the retardation. Therefore, here minus gt. Therefore, the vertical component of the velocity at the position P will now be equal to the initial component, that is u sin alpha minus g into t. Therefore, v sin theta is equal to u sin alpha minus g into t. So, you have to understand it very clearly. So, u is the initial velocity. It is projected at an angle alpha. The horizontal component of the initial velocity is u cos alpha. And the vertical component of initial velocity is u sin alpha. After a certain time, the particle reaches the position P. So, at this position P, the velocity of the projectile is v, and the projectile is making an angle of theta with the horizontal. Now, at this particular position, the vertical component of velocity is v sin theta, so which will not be equal to u sin alpha. So, here v sin theta will be equal to, so there will be some difference or decrease in velocity. So, it decreases by an amount of g into t because of retardation. So, you have u sin alpha minus g into t. So, you have to note it down here. V sin theta is equal to u sin alpha minus g into t. Whereas, the horizontal component of velocity, there will not be any change. It will be same as the initial velocity, that is u cos alpha. Therefore, v cos theta is equal to u cos alpha. Now, so we have the two equations previously, equation 1 and 2. So, we are squaring those two equations 1 and 2 and adding the same. So, after simplification, so we get v is equal to, so we are doing some simplifications here. So, we are getting sin square theta plus cos square theta. We know that sin square theta plus cos square theta is equal to 1. So, after substituting, we get v is equal to this equation. Now, after getting the v, and also we know that we have to find out the angle theta. So, the angle theta is nothing but the projectile makes with the horizontal at the point P. So, that can be again found out by dividing equation 1 and 2. So, which we got in the previous slide. So, you have equations 1 and 2. So, by dividing the equation 1 by 2, so we get V sin theta by V cos theta. So, you get an equation like this, that is tan theta is equal to U sin alpha minus GT divided by U cos alpha. Now, if you look at this particular equation, you can note that so, the numerator u sin alpha minus gt is nothing but the final, the vertical velocity after t seconds. So, u sin alpha minus gt, it's the vertical velocity after t seconds. And u cos alpha is nothing but horizontal component of the initial velocity. Therefore, simply we can get the angle which the projectile makes with the horizontal after a certain interval of time t can be found out using this simple equation. That is tan theta is equal to vertical component or vertical velocity after t seconds divided by horizontal component of the initial velocity. So, using this simple equation, so we can get the angle which the projectile makes with the horizontal at the point t. Now, with this, with these equations, let us try to understand some of the problems. So, you have a particle which is projected upwards with a velocity of 100 meter per second at an angle of 45 degree to the horizontal. When it reaches a certain point P, it is found to be moving at an angle of 30 degree to the horizontal. Find the time for the particle to reach the point P and distance OP. So, you have to find the time for the particle to reach the point P, and also you have to find out the distance OP. So, that is the question. And here, the velocity of projection is given, so that is 100 meter per second, and the angle of projection is given, that is 45 degree, and it reaches a certain point P. So, when it reaches a certain point P, The angle which the projectile makes with the horizontal is given, that is 30 degree. So here theta is given. So theta is given, so that is 30 degree. So now we have to find out the time taken by the particle to reach the point P, and also we have to get the distance OP. So now we know the equation from the previous slide, tan theta is equal to u sin alpha minus gt divided by u cos alpha. So this u sin alpha minus gt is nothing but the velocity of the particle at the point P. So please understand, this is nothing but the velocity of the particle at the point P. So u sin alpha minus gt divided by u cos alpha. So this u cos alpha is nothing but the initial component of the velocity. So u cos alpha. So now in this equation, theta is known, so 30 degrees. U is given 100 meter per second. Alpha is also given, that is 45 degree. And g is 9.8, so divided by 100 cos 45. So from this equation, so we get the time taken by the particle to reach the point P from O. So we get the time as 3.05 seconds. Now the next question is, you have to find out the distance OP. So in order to get this distance OP, so we need to find out this horizontal distance X and the vertical distance Y. So this horizontal distance X can be found out easily because the horizontal component of the velocity remains same. So knowing the velocity and the time, so we can get the horizontal distance X. So X is nothing but horizontal component of velocity into time. So the horizontal component of velocity is 100 cos 45. So u cos alpha, that is 100 cos 45 into time is 3.05 seconds. So we can get the horizontal distance X simply multiplying the velocity and the time. So we got the X distance as 215.6 meters. Now, in order to find out this vertical distance Y, so we know the equation, that is S is equal to ut plus half at square. Now here, if you look at this equation, since the particle is moving upwards, so the acceleration here becomes retardation. Therefore, here you are getting minus. Now, this uy, so here it is nothing but the vertical component of the velocity. So vertical component of the velocity is nothing but 100 sine 45. So 100 sine 45, so we get the vertical component of velocity as 70.7 meters. So now you substitute in this equation. So y is equal to uy is this, that is 100 sine 45 ut into t minus half gt square. So time is 3.05 seconds again. So after substituting the time and also after substituting this uy value, so you get the distance y as 170 meters. So after knowing the distances x and y, so you can easily calculate the distance OP simply by using OP is equal to, distance OP is equal to root of x square plus y square. So you get the distance OP as 274.6 meters. So let us see this problem again. So here the question is, you have to find the time taken by the particle to reach the point P. So we know this particular equation from the previous slides, where theta is the angle of the projection or the particle or the angle which the particle makes with the horizontal at the point P. So that is given. So from this we get the time taken by the particle to reach point P, and from the figure, if you know this x and y, you can calculate the distance OP. So first we are getting the horizontal distance, which is nothing but the horizontal component of the velocity into time. So horizontal component of the velocity is 100 cos 45 into time. Similarly, the vertical component of the velocity is 100 sin 45. In order to get this distance, we make use of the simple equation of motion. And here it is minus because the particle is moving upwards. And this uy is nothing but 100 sin 45. So from this we get the vertical distance y. After getting the distances x and y, we are calculating simply OP is equal to root of x square plus y square. Now in the last few slides, so we have discussed about the velocity and direction of motion of a projectile after a certain time interval from the instant of projection. And we have seen some of the problems also, so on that particular case. Now we'll see how the velocity and the direction of motion of a projectile will change at a given height above the point of the projection. So now for this, you consider a projectile, so which is projected from the point O as shown here, and here use the velocity of the projection and alpha is the angle of the projection with the horizontal. So now here we are going to see how the velocity and the direction of the motion of projectile changes at a given height h above the point of the projection. So now this O is the point of the projection, and now we are going to see how the velocity and the direction of the motion changes at a given height. So now the given height is h. So after reaching the particular height h, so it reaches the point P. So at this particular point P, V is the velocity of the projectile and theta is the angle which the projectile P makes with the horizontal. So this is the case. So you have a projectile which is projected from the point O at a certain velocity U, and the angle of projection is alpha. So after the projectile reaches a particular height h, the projectile reaches the point P. So at point P, V is the velocity of the projectile and theta is nothing but the angle which the projectile at the P makes with the horizontal. Now for this condition, so we are going to find out how the direction of motion of a projectile and how the velocity of the projectile will change. So now for this, so we know that the initial velocity is u, so it is projected at an angle alpha. Therefore, the vertical component of initial velocity will be u sin alpha. Now, after t seconds, so after it reaches the point P, the vertical component of the final velocity will be equal to v sin theta. Now, this u sin alpha and v sin theta will not be equal or will not be same, because you have some changes in velocity. So this change in velocity, that is from u sin alpha to v sin theta. So it is because of the retardation due to gravity. So as the particle is moving upwards, so it is against the motion of acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, the vertical component of the velocity will not be the same. So initially it was u sin alpha, and after a particular time t seconds, the vertical component of the final velocity will be v sin theta. So this u sin alpha will not be equal to v sin theta. So there will be some difference in velocity because of the retardation g due to gravity. Now, so we know the basic equation of motion, that is v square is equal to u square minus 2as. So now we are going to apply this equation. So v is the final velocity and u is the initial velocity. So the final velocity now is v sin theta and the initial velocity is u sin alpha. So here the acceleration, it becomes g. So since it is a upward motion, so a becomes g and s becomes h. Therefore, when you substitute the initial velocity and the final velocity in this equation, so we get v sin theta is equal to this. That is root of u square sin square alpha minus 2g h. And we know very well that the horizontal component of the velocities will not change. So initially, the horizontal component of the velocity is u cos alpha. And when the projectile reaches the point P, or when it reaches certain height h, again the horizontal component of the velocity is v cos theta. So those two velocities will be equal. So there will not be any change in the horizontal component of the velocity, because we don't have any other external influence like acceleration due to gravity, because it is a horizontal velocity. Therefore, v cos theta will be equal to u cos alpha. So now we have this equation. So we have three equations: equation 1, equation 2, and equation 3. Now, squaring equation. So the here you have a equation of v sin theta, and here you have an equation of v cos theta. So now we are squaring equation. We are squaring these two equations. So when you square these equations, what you'll get? So v square sin square theta, then we are adding. So we are squaring this and this, and we are adding. So we get v square sin square theta plus v square cos square theta is equal to u square sin square alpha minus 2gh plus u square cos square alpha. So we are squaring this equation, we are squaring this equation, and we are adding those two equations. So we get an equation like this, or we get v square is equal to u square minus 2gh, or v is equal to root of u square minus 2gh. Now, in order to find out this theta, so this theta is nothing but the angle which the particle makes with the horizontal at the point P, that is theta. So we have to find out this theta. So that can be found out easily from equations 2, 1, 3. So we are dividing equation 2 by 3. So V sine theta by V cos theta. So we'll get V tan theta. We get tan theta. So after from the equations 2, 1, 3, so we can get tan theta is equal to this equation. So if you look at this particular equation, so in the numerator, you can see it is root of u square sine square alpha minus 2g h. So this is nothing but the vertical velocity at a height h. So that is nothing but v sine theta. So it's nothing but the vertical velocity at a height h. And this u cos alpha is nothing but the horizontal component of the initial velocity. So in order to find out this theta, you need these two components. One is the vertical velocity at a height h, and another one is the horizontal component of the initial velocity. Now with this, we'll solve a problem. So you have a body which is projected upwards with a velocity of 50 meter per second at an angle of 50 degree with the horizontal. What will be its velocity and direction at a height 30 meter? So you have to find out the velocity and direction of motion of a body at a height of 30 meter from the point of projection. So given the velocity, initial velocity of projection, that is u is given 50 meter per second, and the angle of projection is given, that is alpha is given, that is 50 degree. And the height h is given, that is 30 meters. So at this particular height, you have to find the velocity of the projectile and also the direction, that means that theta. Theta is nothing but the angle which the projectile makes with the horizontal. So we have derived the equations in the previous slide. So we know the velocity is v is equal to root of u square minus 2gh. So from this, we are substituting all the values and we are getting the value of v. So this is nothing but the velocity of the projectile at a height of 30 meters. And in order to find the direction of the projectile, we simply make use of the equation of tan theta. So tan theta is equal to root of u square sine square alpha minus 2gh divided by u cos alpha. So this is nothing but the vertical velocity at the point P, which is v sine theta. So you know this equation. So here u is known, alpha is known, h is also known. So after substituting all the known values, we get tan theta is equal to this, and from this we get the angle of the projectile at a height of 30 meter as 42.7 degrees. Now so far we have discussed about the motion of a projectile on a horizontal plane. So there are certain situations in which the projectile can be projected on an inclined plane also. So now here if you look at this diagram, so here again this point O is nothing but the point of projection, but it is projected on an inclined plane. So the angle of inclination of the plane is beta with respect to horizontal, and again this u is nothing but the initial velocity of the projection, and it is projected at an angle of alpha with respect to horizontal. So if you please note here, this alpha is the angle of projection with respect to horizontal. It is not with respect to inclined plane. This beta is again the angle of inclination of the inclined plane with respect to horizontal. So now again we have to find out the time of flight for this projectile when it is projected on an inclined plane. So this time of flight is from O to B. Okay, so this is the point at which the projectile is projected, and this is the point at which it reaches. It's the final point. So time of flight is nothing but the time taken by the projectile to travel from O to D. So you have to find out this time of flight. So again, the diagram is given here. So for better explanation. So now this is the plane OA. So normal to the plane OA is nothing but the perpendicular to this plane. So now we have the acceleration since it is projected upwards again in an inclined plane. So here the acceleration effect will come into picture. So the acceleration due to gravity will be acting in this direction. So since it is an inclined plane, so you have to resolve this acceleration due to gravity, one along the plane and another one perpendicular to the plane. So now let us first find out the component of the initial velocity normal to the plane, that is perpendicular to the plane. So what is the component of the initial velocity? So the initial velocity is u. So this is alpha. That is, alpha is nothing but the angle which the velocity makes with the horizontal. And this beta is nothing but the angle of inclination of the inclined plane. Therefore, if you find out the component of initial velocity normal to the plane, so normal to the plane, so you have to subtract this angle, alpha minus beta. Therefore, the component of initial velocity will be normal to the plane, OA will be u into sine alpha minus beta. So you understand clearly, the alpha is the total angle, this beta is the angle of inclination of the inclined plane. So now we are getting the component of the velocity normal to the plane. So this is the plane, we are getting the component of the velocity normal to the plane. Therefore, we are subtracting this angle. So u sine alpha minus beta. So similarly, the acceleration due to gravity will be acting downwards like this. So you have to resolve this acceleration due to gravity also normal to the plane. So this is normal to the plane. So this is the plane. So this is normal. This is perpendicular to the plane. So you have to resolve this acceleration due to gravity also perpendicular to this plane. So the g is the acceleration due to gravity. So now if you look at this diagram, this is beta. So this angle is 90 degree. So this angle will be 90 minus beta. This plane and this normal are perpendicular to each other. So if this is 90 minus beta, this will be equal to beta. So I'm repeating again, this is beta. So this is vertical, exactly vertical. That is the direction of acceleration due to gravity. If this is beta, this is 90 degree. This is 90 minus beta. In this triangle, this angle will be 90 minus beta. Therefore, this plane and this line are perpendicular to each other. So this is normal. If this is 90 minus beta, this is going to be beta. So if you resolve the acceleration due to gravity normal to the plane, so this is g, this is beta. So this, the component of acceleration due to gravity normal to the plane will be g cos. So g cos beta. G cos beta. So you have to understand clearly. Now the acceleration due to gravity along the plane simply. So this g we are resolving, one along this direction, one along this direction. This is along the plane and this is normal to the plane. So normal to the plane it is g cos beta, and along the plane it is g sine beta. Okay, now we are considering the motion of a projectile normal to the plane. We are considering the motion of the projectile normal to the plane. That is, we are considering the motion from O to B normal to the plane. Now, if you know very well that at point B, y is equal to 0. The distance traveled by the projectile will be equal to 0. So this is y. So y at various points. So at the point B, this y will be equal to 0. So you know the equation for y, just nothing but the basic equation of motion. So you know this s is equal to ut minus half gt square. Since the particle is projected upwards, here you have the minus sign. So you know the basic equation ut minus half gt square. Now at the point B, y is equal to 0. So we are substituting y is equal to 0. And this u is nothing but this velocity. That is component of initial velocity normal to the plane OA. So normal to the plane OA, the distance covered by the projectile will be 0. Therefore, here u, we are substituting u sine alpha minus beta minus half g. So here again, the component of acceleration to the due to gravity normal to the plane. So here in this direction. So here we get g cos beta. So after substituting this, s is equal to 0 and also g is equal to g cos beta and u is equal to u sine alpha minus beta. So we get time is equal to 2u sine alpha minus beta divided by g cos beta. So this is nothing but the total time of flight, that is from O to B. So we are getting the total time of flight, that is the time taken by the projectile to travel from O to B, from the basic equation of motion. So by applying the condition that the distance covered by the projectile normal to the plane at the point B is 0, that is the distance is 0. So from this condition, we are calculating the time taken by the projectile to travel from O to B. So we got T is equal to this equation. Now, this is the case where the projectile is projected upwards. Now, if you consider a case of a projectile when it is projected downwards in an inclined plane, now simply, so here in this equation, instead of beta, you have to substitute minus beta. That's all. So this is the case of a projectile which is projected upward or up an inclined plane. Suppose if you have a projectile which is projected on a downward inclined plane, in that case, instead of simply beta, you have to substitute minus beta. Therefore, now your equation will become T is equal to 2u sin alpha plus beta divided by g cos beta. Okay, so this is the equation. Now we'll see some of the problems in order to calculate the time of flight. So when a particle is projected in an inclined plane. So this is a problem where a ball is projected from a point with a velocity of 10 meters per second on an inclined plane. The angle of projection and the inclination of the plane are 35 degree and 15 degree respectively with the horizontal. Find the time of flight of the ball when it is projected upwards and downwards the plane. So you have two cases here. The ball is projected upwards as well as the ball is projected downwards. So when you have to calculate the time of flight of the ball. So already we have derived the equations for the time of flight in the previous slide. So the time of flight is given by this equation. So this is for the upward projection case. So when the ball is projected downwards, your beta will become minus beta. Therefore, the equation will get modified like this. Now, the initial velocity is given 10 meter per second. And here the angle of inclination of plane is given as 15 degree. So beta is equal to 15 degree and the angle of projection alpha is given as 35 degree. So all the data are given. So you have to simply substitute in this equation to get the time of flight. So for two different cases, one is when the ball is projected upwards and the second one is when the ball is projected downwards. And here simply you have to substitute beta is equal to minus 15. So you'll get plus beta here. So that is the difference. So you can calculate easily the time of flight when the particle is projected upwards and downwards on an inclined plane. Now let us find out the range of the projectile on an inclined plane. So far we have seen how to calculate the time of flight when the particle is projected on an inclined plane, whether it is projected upwards or projected downwards. Now here let us see how to find out the range of a projectile on an inclined plane. And I hope this diagram is clear. So we know the time of flight. So we start with time of flight. So the time of flight equation is 2u sin alpha minus beta divided by g cos beta. So we have to find out first the horizontal component of the range. Actually, this is the range. So this O, B is the range, the inclined distance. So as we have discussed previously, the ranges can be either horizontal or inclined. So in the case of a particle projection on an inclined plane, the range will be, of course, an inclined one. But now let us first find out the horizontal component of the range. So this OC is the horizontal component of the range. In fact, this OB is the inclined range. So the horizontal component of the range will be OC. So in order to find out the horizontal component of the range, so first we need the horizontal component of the velocity. So horizontal component of the velocity is u cos alpha, since alpha is nothing but the angle of projection which it makes with the horizontal. Therefore, the horizontal component of the velocity is u cos alpha. So velocity into time will give the distance. Therefore, u cos alpha into the time. So time is nothing but the total time of flight. So which we have got in the previous slides. So when you substitute this, so we got the horizontal component of the range, that is OC. So this is OC, this is the horizontal component of the range as this. Now we have to find out the actual range, that is OB, because we have to find out this R. So from the triangle, you consider this triangle. So this is beta. Beta is the angle of inclination of the inclined plane. So what is cos beta from this? Cos beta is adjacent side by hypotenuse. So cos beta is equal to OC divided by R. So cos beta is equal to OC divided by R. So from this, what is R? is equal to OC by cos theta. So now we know what is OC. So after substituting OC here, we get the range as this. Now, similar to the problems on an horizontal plane, so we can find out the condition at which the range is maximum. So now if you look at this equation, the range will be maximum when sine 2 alpha minus beta is maximum, because here the velocity u, the acceleration due to gravity g and beta, so they are all constants, so we cannot change that. Therefore, this range r will be maximum when sine 2 alpha minus beta is maximum. So when sine 2 alpha minus beta will be maximum? So when this 2 alpha minus beta will be 90 degrees, because sine 90 is equal to 1. Therefore, when this 2 alpha minus beta is equal to 90 degrees, we get the maximum range. So when you substitute this 2 alpha minus beta as 90 degrees, so we get 2 alpha minus beta is equal to pi by 2, or alpha is equal to this. So the alpha should be this. Therefore, in order to get the maximum range, the value of alpha or the particle should be projected at this particular angle of inclination. So for maximum range, alpha is equal to pi by 4 plus b by 2. Now after substituting this alpha in the R equation, that is in the previous equation of range, we are substituting alpha is equal to pi by 4 plus b by 2. So from this we get the maximum range as u square divided by g into 1 plus sine beta. So this is the equation for the maximum range. Now suppose if the particle is again projected downwards in an inclined plane. So here when the particle is projected on a downward inclined plane, so instead of beta you have to substitute minus beta. Therefore, in the range equation itself, you have to substitute beta equal to minus beta. Similarly, the alpha, there you got pi by 2 plus pi by 4 plus b by beta by 2, but here it is minus beta by 2. Similarly, r maximum, here we are getting plus beta for upward projection. For downward, in the case of an outward inclined plane, here this becomes minus beta. So that's all. So for the problems of projectiles just projected on a downward inclined plane, instead of beta, you have to substitute minus beta in the equations for R and also alpha and also R maximum. Now let us see some of the problems here in order to find out the range of a projectile just projected on an inclined plane. So here a particle is projected upwards. A particle is projected from a point on an inclined plane with a velocity of 30 meter per second. The angle of projection and the angle of plane are 55 degree and 20 degree to the horizontal respectively. Show that the range up the plane is maximum 1 for the given plane. Find the range and the time of flight of the particle. So now the question here is, the initial velocity is given. The angle of projection, that is alpha, is given 55 degree. Angle of plane, that is beta, is given 20 degree. You have to show that the range up the plane is maximum 1 for the given plane. So now here everything is given, that is alpha is given and beta is given. So we know that for the maximum range, the alpha should be pi by 4 plus beta by 2. So this is the alpha for maximum range. Now you just substitute the values of beta here. So pi by 4 plus beta by 2. When you substitute the value of beta here in this equation, alpha, you get alpha as 55 degree. So in the problem also it is given that alpha is 55 degree. Therefore, what we can conclude is that the range up the plane is maximum 1 for the given plane. So here the plane is given with the value of alpha and beta. And we know that for maximum range, the angle of projection should be pi by 4 plus beta by 2. So the angle of projection given here is 55 degree, which is same as that we get from this alpha. Therefore, the range will be maximum for the given angle of projection. So that we can conclude first of all. And the second thing is we have to find the range of the projectile. So for the range, we know this equation. So we have to simply substitute the values of u, alpha and beta. So from this, we get the range of 68.43 meters. And also you have to get the time of flight. So time of flight also, we have this basic equation, which we have derived in the previous slides. So simply substitute the values of alpha and beta to get the time of flight. So since and also you can calculate the maximum range also from the equation. So this is the equation for maximum range. So when you substitute all the values in the equation of maximum range, you get 68.43 meters. Now the next problem is a plane has a rise of 5 and 12. A shot is projected with a velocity of 200 meter per second at an elevation of 30 degrees. Find the range of the plane if the shot is fired up the plane, and the second case is if the shot is fired down the plane. So here you have two cases. One is projected in an upward plane, and the second one is projected in a downward plane. And here the velocity of projection is given 200 meter per second, that is u is 200 meter per second. And here angle of projection is given, that is 30 degree. So here you have a small twist. So instead of giving directly the angle of the inclination of the inclined plane, it is given here the plane has a rise of 5 in 12. So you have to find out the angle of inclination of the inclined plane from this. 5 and 12. Okay. So now you have to find out the range. So this is the range equation for the first case, that is when the projectile is projected on an upward plane. So here the alpha is given 30 degrees and beta you have to find out. So so rise of 5 in 12. So 5 and 12. So from this 5 and 12 you have to find out this beta. So from this you get beta as 22.6 degrees. So you have to get the slope of the inclined plane from this data. So we get the slope as 22.6 degrees. So after knowing the values of alpha and beta, so we can find out the range from the known equation. Similarly, if it is down the inclined plane, instead of beta, you have to substitute minus beta. So the equation gets modified as plus beta here. So simply you have to substitute the values in order to get the ranges for the two cases. When the shot is fired up the plane, and similarly when the shot is fired down the plane. So with this we conclude our discussion on the projectile motion. So we have discussed the two cases where the motion of the projectile is on a horizontal plane, and similarly when the motion of the projectile is on an inclined plane. So for the both the cases we have seen how to find out the time of flight and what is the maximum height reached by the projectile, and similarly what is the range of the projectile. So for this particular lecture I have referred these two references for the preparation of my lecture. So and we have seen some of the problems also. We have seen many problems so on the projectile motion, both covering horizontal plane as well as inclined planes. Thank you.